Hello everyone, wish you all a wonderful day. This is Dr. Yugandhar and I welcome you all again back to Pharmaceutics, and we are yet to complete our remaining objectives under the topic suppositories. Well, today we are going to start the third part of suppositories, and before that we have the course objectives to look in as a formality, and all these course objectives remains the same and as usual, like what we have been discussing from the beginning of our video sessions. And then as usual we also have the ground rules for the class, and all these ground rules again remains the same for this video also. Well, now let me explain you about the objectives and clear structure of the lecture. At the end of the unit, students should be able to understand the various objectives, like what are all we have covered, starting from definition of suppositories till the packaging and storage of suppositories in two different parts, suppositories part 1 and suppositories part 2, which have been completed already. And in this current video we are going to discuss about the various problems facing in the formulation of suppositories. That means the various problems what we are going to face while formulating the suppositories, and this objective in detail along with the various problems and the various rectification or remedial measures and solutions for these problems we are going to discuss in this part of the video, that is suppositories part 3 video. And we will be left over with the evaluation or quality control test for suppositories, and that I will be covering in my further video, that is part 4 of suppositories. Well, let me quickly start the first objective, that is the problems in formulation of suppositories. So, and this will be the first and the last objective for this video, and in the next video we are going to cover the remaining objective. Well, to discuss about the problems we are facing during the formulation of suppositories, we should always remember that we need to depend on two major things for formulating a good suppository formulation. The first one is active pharmaceutical ingredient, or the drug or the medication or the medicament which is present in the formulation, with the second one, that is an appropriate suppository base. So these are the two major ingredients or major combinations or major components what we need for formulating suppositories. While preparing the formulations of suppositories, we come across so many difficulties, so many problems or so many issues. So among all those, I have listed out the 10 major issues or 10 major problems, starting from 1 to 10. So let me quickly read out them. The first one, the first problem is the water in suppositories. Second problem is hygroscopicity, and the third problem is drug excipient interactions, and fourth problem is density, and fifth problem is viscosity, sixth problem is rancidity, seventh problem is brittleness, eighth problem is lubrication of the suppository molds, ninth problem is volume contraction, and the last one, tenth problem, is displacement value. So all these creates so many issues while formulating the suppositories. So being pharmacists, we have to keep in mind about all the rectification or remedial measures to overcome these issues. And these all problems are like locks which will block our minds. So we have to remember always that every lock has a key. There is no lock without a key. All locks are made with its own key. Same way, all the problems has their own solutions, right? Their own rectifications. Fine. So let me depend on the lock and key. So the lock we consider as a problem, and the key we consider as a remedial measure for the throughout session of this video. Well, the first problem was the water in suppositories. Formulations are which are manufactured as suppositories in laboratories are normally made by pharmacists, whereas the same are manufactured in industries by competent persons. We call them as formulators, and these formulators do not like to use water for dissolving drugs in suppositories for so many reasons. And those reasons include: number A, because the water causes oxidation of fats. So we know most of the bases are fatty in nature. And number B, if the suppositories are manufactured at high temperature, the water will get evaporated and the drug will start crystallizing. So that's what they say, if the suppositories are manufactured at high temperature, then the water evaporates and the drugs will start crystallizing out. Then number C, absorption of water soluble drugs is enhanced only in that condition if the base is an oil in water type of emulsion with more than 50% of the water in the external phase. And number D, the drug excipient interactions are more likely to happen in presence of water. And number E, if water is present, then it will invite the bacterial contamination. The moisture content is more suitable for bacterial contamination. That is the reason number E is as a reason for bacterial contamination, which may be a problem, and so we may be forced to add a preservative. Whether it is prescribed or not prescribed, we have to use them, right? And all these remains as a big lock, right? Of course, we do have a key to open it or to unlock it. So how we are going to rectify all these issues, that is the problem of water in suppositories or moisture content in suppositories, is to avoid not to use water and use an appropriate suppository base which need not require any moisture or any water content, right? So while selecting the suppository base, we have to choose an appropriate one. That is the major solution for this problem, that is water in suppositories. The next one is a major problem again, that is hygroscopicity. We all know that the material which is having hygroscopicity, or the material which is called as hygroscopic, they tend to absorb moisture present in environment or surroundings and start liquefying, right? So in our case of a suppository bases, the glycerogelatin suppositories lose moisture in dry climates and start absorbing moisture in humid conditions. So the glycerogelatin suppositories has both the properties, right? If the condition, if the environment is dry, if the climate is dry, so it will lose the moisture, it will lose its own water content. Suppose if the environment is humid, right? If the climate is humid, then it will start absorbing moisture from the environment. And the hygroscopicity of polyethylene glycol bases depends on the chain length of the molecule, right? And the hygroscopicity of polyethylene glycol bases depends on the chain length of the molecule. We remember the PEGs, what we are using as suppository bases, should be of high molecular weight, right? Above 1000, right? 1000 and above we consider, right? So on that case, we have to be precise on selecting a PEG as a base. Even as the molecular weight of these ethylene oxide polymers increases, the hygroscopicity decreases. That is what they say. As the molecular weight of these ethylene oxide polymers increases, the hygroscopicity decreases, right? And these all remains as a big lock for us, right? The hygroscopicity is a big problem, and to unlock or to overcome this problem, we have a key step. We have to avoid, select an appropriate base having the optimum density which is required, right? So optimum hygroscopicity, right? Not the density here. So it should be hygroscopicity, right? It should not have the property of hygroscopicity, right? That's what it is supposed to be. So by mistake, it is a typographical error. It is mentioned as density in your slide. Fine, doesn't matter. This is how you are going to unlock this problem. And next problem is drug excipient interaction. The drug excipient interactions include different types of interactions, starting from incompatibilities or crystallization or softening of the suppository base or decomposition of active ingredient like penicillin G, etc. Right? So I have considered, for instance, these few examples. Right? Let me explain you one by one. The first one, the incompatibilities exist between polyethylene glycol base and some drugs. So you have to be very selective in this case. And similarly, when sodium barbital and salicylic acid are used as active ingredients, they tend to crystallize out with the polyethylene glycol, right? If the base is suppository base is of PEG base, then sodium barbital or salicylic acid are the active ingredients. They tend to crystallize out, and if the crystals are formed, we know after its dissolution or disintegration, they tend to cause irritation in rectal mucosal layers. Well, the next one is high concentrations of salicylic acid will soften the polyethylene glycol to an ointment like consistency. You can observe in the picture, right? The thick mass of the suppository base will become soft and appear like a ointment or a creamy substance. Similarly, penicillin G, if it is used as active ingredient, which is stable in cocoa butter and other fatty bases also, but the same penicillin G will decompose in PEG bases. So as long as penicillin G is the active ingredient, you can very much choose cocoa butter. There is no issue. And even you can sometimes even you choose fatty bases, then also there won't be any issue. But if you use PEG bases for this particular drug, it will decompose, right? The penicillin G will be decomposed, right? Whether it may be an incompatibility problem or crystallization problem or softening of the suppository base or decomposition of penicillin G like active ingredients, so can be overcome. All these problems can be unlocked or overcome by using a key step, that is select an appropriate suppository base. Simple, because we know strong basic background of selecting the appropriate suppository base on the grounds of selection of ideal suppository base, what we have discussed earlier. The next problem is density. We all know that density is mass per volume, that is given as P equals to M by V. So, well, the density of the suppository base, the density of the drug, the volume of the mold, and whether the base is having the property of volume contraction are all important factors, and they affect the final product of your suppository. So they all determine the weight of the suppository. That means they all determine the final weight of the suppository, right? And this remains as a issue, or this remains as a problem. And to unlock this problem, or to overcome this problem, or to resolve this problem, we have to avoid this by selecting an appropriate base having the optimum density which is required for the formulation. Optimum density, entire formulation mixture should possess an optimum density for the stability, right? Well, the next problem is viscosity. So when the base has low viscosity, there may be a possibility of sedimentation of the drug within the suppository, and that is a major problem. You can observe in the picture, one suppository you have at the left hand side of your handout, right? So I have mentioned with blue dots, right? That is representing the drug particles, right? So if the suppository base is having less viscosity, then the drug particles may have a tendency to settle down at the bottom, and that process is called a sedimentation of the drug, and that is a problem. So to overcome this problem, or to unlock this problem, or to avoid this, we have to use 2% aluminium monostearate, which may be added to increase the viscosity of the base, or cetyl and sterile alcohols or stearic acid are added to improve the consistency of the suppositories. So these are the two key steps with which we can unlock this problem, right? Well, the next problem is rancidity. We have discussed already about rancidity, what is rancidity and what are all the drawbacks it is causing in formulation of suppositories earlier in our previous video session, right? Well, now let us look into this. The unsaturated fatty acids in the suppository bases undergo auto-oxidation and decompose into aldehydes, ketones and acids. And the rancidity may be due to hydrolysis or may be due to oxidation, right? For example, you can have a look at the diagram here. I have given two oil drops of the same composition. So one is in fresh form of an oil, and the second one, which is in brown color, is the rancid drop of an oil, right? And these products, if they decompose, they may give unpleasant odor, or they may result in strong unpleasant odor, right? And which is a major drawback and which is a major problem. To avoid this problem, or to unlock this problem, the lower the content of unsaturated fatty acids in a base, the higher is the resistance to rancidity. That means what? The rancidity resistance can be increased by ensuring that the content of unsaturated fatty acids in the selected base is low. Then the rancidity problem can be solved, right? So while selecting the base, you have to keep this factor in mind. The next problem is brittleness. So brittleness in the sense, the tendency of a material to get broken, right? For example, you consider a piece of chalk, right? Even if you drop at a very small height on a surface, the chalk piece or piece of chalk may tend to break. That is because of its brittleness. It is more brittle. Even glass, for that matter, glass plate, right? When you drop plainly from a very small height on a plane, another plane solid surface, the glass plate may tend to break. That is because of the brittleness, right? And that is about the brittleness. Well, the cocoa butter, when you are using as a suppository base, they are elastic in nature and they are not brittle, right? The cocoa butter suppository, you can see the brownish color one, what you have at the right hand side of your handout. And when you are choosing cocoa butter, this normally will not have this problem. So no problem there. Well, when you are using synthetic fat as a suppository base, then this has a property of brittleness. The suppository which is made by synthetic fat as a base is brittle, right? And this brittleness causes the breakdown of the suppository, and that is a problem. and this problem can be unlocked or this problem can be overcome by keeping the temperature difference between the melted base and the mold as small as possible. That means the melted base, in the sense, suppose you are melting it with a particular temperature, and see to that when you are pouring into the mold cavities, the molten mass of the mixture of suppository base along with the drug, when you are transferring or pouring into the mold cavity, you ensure that the cooling temperature is very close by to the melting point. You don't keep a very big range, right? Drastic cooling or over cooling should be avoided here, right? And thereby you have to maintain a very small gap between hot and cool temperatures, right? Cool, I mean to say, between the process of heating and cooling, the range, the difference range should be very narrow, right? So to unsolve this problem, you can follow this, and the material that impart plasticity to a fat and make them less brittle are examples. We have substances like Tween 80, castor oil, glycerin or propylene glycol. Either you can use one among these or few of these, or you can follow the temperature gap maintaining method to overcome this issue. The next problem is lubrication of molds, right? We already discussed about the various lubricant and how we are lubricating the molds, right? So you can again have a look at this picture. What you have at the left hand side, it is a complete suppository mold in which the two halves of the suppository mold has been fixed by a big screw at the middle portion, and where you can see the entire and complete cavities. There are totally six cavities present in the mold. So when you unscrew this, it will be separated into two halves, like what you have seen at the right hand side, right? And even the cavities, you get two halves which are separated, right? So normally lubrication of molds include you have to use lubricating agents. For lubricating agents include liquid paraffin and glycerin. Liquid paraffin or glycerin, any one you can use by means of a brush. The next problem is volume contraction. On solidification of the volume of the suppository decreases. That means when you try to solidify the volume after melting the mixture and adding into the suppository mold, when you try to solidify the volume of the suppository, on solidification the volume of the suppository may tend to decrease. When you fill, when it is in liquid form or melted form, it will occupy the complete volume of the suppository mold cavity. But on cooling, you tend to see it has gone inside. Then you can see a depression within the cavity above the surface of the suppository, right? And that is because of the contraction, right? That's what they say, on solidification or on cooling, the volume of the suppository decreases and the mass of the suppository pulls away from the sides of the mold, and this is a problem, and this is a major problem. And this contraction helps the suppository to easily slip away from the mold, preventing the need for a lubricating agent. So this contraction helps the suppository to easily slip away from the mold because it is already contracted, it is not tightly bound to the walls, it is slippery, and thereby it can be easily slip away from the mold, preventing the need of a lubricating agent. And it is not an advantage, it is a drawback, it is a problem, because when there is a contraction in the volume, there will be difference in weight also. Sometimes when the suppository mass is contracting, a hole forms at the open end, right? At the above surface you can see there is depressions or there are holes because of the air gaps, because while contracting, the surfaces tend to pull the mass inward to the cavity, and thereby it is allowing the air bubbles to happen there, and that causes this type of issue. Sometimes when the suppository mass is contracting, a hole forms at the opening. Hole, right? You can see a big hole has been formed there above the surface, and that is because of this contraction. And this gives an inelegant appearance to the suppository, right? So defected suppository we call it as, right? And along with that, there may be a possibility of weight variation among the suppositories, which may also likely to occur. So, well, to overcome this problem or to unlock this issue, this type of contraction can be minimized by pouring the suppository mass slightly above the congealing temperature into a mold warmed to about the same temperature. Another way is to remove this problem is to overfill the molds and scrap off the excess mass which contains the contraction hole, right? So this is another type where you can overfill the cavities, right? You ensure there is excess amount has been poured, and later you can scrap it out, because on the upper surface it may form holes that can be removed, right? So these are the two key steps you can follow to avoid this type of issue. The next and last problem or issue is displacement value, right? So you have to remember this, and this is very, very important factor you have to remember throughout your memory as long as you are involved in the formulation of suppositories, right? So let me explain you what is displacement value. The displacement value may be defined as the number of parts by weight of medicament that displaces one part by weight of the base. So we all know that in formulation of suppositories, we have two major things, major ingredients. One is suppository base, other one is active ingredient, right? Suppository base is different chemical substance, and your active ingredient is a different chemical substance. So both will have different densities or different masses, different weights, right? So because you know that we are going to formulate the suppositories by volumetric method, we are just filling the cavities, we are not weighing the molten mass and then pouring, we are not doing gravimetry method, we are doing filling method, just volumetrically filling the cavities, right? So well, that is how the displacement value may be defined as the number of parts by weight of a medicament that displaces one part by weight of the base, right? So one part of the base is displaced by how many parts of the drug. That value we call it as displacement value in simple terms. Well, I will explain you in detail about this issue, that is displacement value. Well, to talk about the displacement value as a problem or an issue in formulation of suppositories, we know that we have to choose a combination of drug and base. When you combine drug along with the base, that is suppository base, the drug displaces certain amount of the suppository base, and finally you get a suppository, right? For example, if you are formulating by using a 2-gram suppository mold, each suppository will weigh 2 grams, right? Should weigh 2 grams, let us suppose like that, fine? Let us see what is the issue here. The volume of suppositories from a particular mold will be constant, but the weight will vary because the densities of the medicaments usually differ from the densities of the bases, and hence the density of the medicament will affect the amount of the base which is required for each suppository, right? So this is an issue, as what I said earlier, right? Because the suppository base will have a particular density, whereas the active ingredient or the drug may have a particular density, and both will not the same. Since we are using volumetric filling, we have to keep in mind we are just filling volumetrically, we are not weighing. So for that reason, we also know what is displacement value, right? Let us recall, displacement value is the number of parts by mass of the drug which displaces one part by mass of the suppository base is called as displacement value. Well, the volume of suppositories from a particular mold will be constant, but the weight will vary because of the densities of the medicaments, which usually differ from the densities of the base, and hence the density of the medicament will affect the amount of the base which is required for each suppository, right? Well, for explanation, let me explain in this way. You can have a look at this picture, right? At one side you have blue colored suppositories, and other side you have multicolored suppositories, right? The first one, first category, right, here also you have 6, and second category also you have 6. The first category of suppositories are those suppositories which are made only by using the base alone, suppository base alone, right? So each suppository suppository mold cavity is having 2 gram capacity. That means once you fill, it may produce a suppository which is weighing 2 grams, right? So for 6 suppositories, you get a theoretical weight. When you add up all the 6 times 2, it will be 12 grams, right? Let us consider this as a theoretical weight. Well, coming to other side, the multicolored suppositories, which are prepared by using the combination of suppository base along with the drug, right? It is a combination of base plus API, right? So we have to get even, because the volume remains constant here, we have to get even in this case 2 gram suppository from each cavity. But ultimately, when we check the weight, we consider that weight as practical weight, we get 14 grams. So among 14 grams, we know how much weight of drug has been incorporated for 6 suppositories. Say, by considering each suppository should have 500 milligrams or half a gram of the active medicament, we have selected 3 grams of the drug, right? So 3 grams of the drug, when you deduct from the practical weight, that is 14 grams, you get the difference as 11 grams. That is the base. So total weight is 14 grams. We know that we have incorporated 3 grams of the active ingredient, and the difference is 11 grams, and that 11 grams is nothing but the suppository base. So whereas in case of theoretical weight, how many grams we are getting for 6 suppositories? 12 grams. And out of 12 grams, 11 grams is already here. 11 grams are already here in this case, right? So what is the difference? The difference between the 14 and 11 is 3. That means 3 grams of the drug are displacing 1 gram of suppository base. You understand this? So thereby, the displacement value of this particular drug is 3, right? Likewise, every drug will have its own displacement value. You have to refer the standard chart or referral table for the drugs which are used by you while formulating the suppositories, and you have to apply those to manipulate the calculation while formulating suppositories. Well, let us consider that we have 6 empty suppository molds, each of 2 grams, like I said earlier. Now, if we fill these suppository molds with only base without any drug, then the total weight of the base required to filling will be equal to 6 times 2, that is equal to 12 grams, like what I said earlier. And this will be considered as theoretical weight of suppository base. Well, now you look into the next slide of your handout, that is theoretical weight is 12 plus 3, that is 15 grams, right? Because you are taking 12 grams and it is 15 grams. And there is a difference 1 gram, right? So that is practical weight, you are getting 14 grams, and theoretical weight, you are getting 15 grams, right? Theoretically, if you calculate, you get 15 grams, whereas practically, when you are calculating, you are getting 14 grams. So what is the difference? 1 gram. So therefore, 1 gram of the base is displaced by 3 grams of drug. In other words, previously I said 3 grams of drug displacing 1 gram of base. In other words, you can also write as 1 gram of base is displaced by 3 grams of the drug, and therefore the displacement value for that particular drug is 3. Right? You can look into the explanation. Theoretical weight of the base is 12 grams. Theoretical weight of the drug is 3 grams. Theoretical weight of the base plus drug, that is combination, is 12 plus 3, that is 15 grams. But we found the practical weight of 6 suppositories as 14 grams only. So the difference will be equal to 15 minus 14 is equal to 1 gram. So therefore 1 gram of base is displaced by 3 grams of drug, and thereby the displacement value is 3. So well, we have quickly completed 10 major problems which are influencing, are troubling, are causing issues during formulation of suppositories. Well, we can quickly look into the summary. In the previous video sessions, we have covered all the objectives, starting from the definition of suppositories till the packaging and storage of suppositories. And in this video, that is part 3 of suppositories, we have completed problems in formulation of suppositories. Well, as I said earlier, in our next video or next session, I will be covering the evaluation tests as well as the quality control tests of the suppositories. So well, I have given few references here, so you can go through all these. And now it's time to end with a high note, and today's high note and quote is same: every lock has a key and every problem has a solution. So whatever the problem we get, we have to apply our knowledge, we have to think critically and solve the problem by using an appropriate solution, as every lock has its own key, and there are no lock which is made without a key, right? And this is a quote for the day: every lock has a key and every problem has a solution. And this great quotation is given by Thomas John, right? So with this, I conclude this video session. Thank you very much. Have a safe day.